knows a lot about all kinds of stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
Over the past few tutorials, we have seen how the empirical and overall scientific focus of the analytic tradition is quite evident, and it was only natural that philosophy of science thrived in new developments. Not only that, but Wittgenstein's blow to a positivist model of science also affected how other schools of thought dealt with interdisciplinary studies. Naturalism then became the umbrella term which denotes most post-analytic philosophical theories with a focus on dialoguing with other scientific areas against abstract metaphysics, as the Vienna Circle originally intended, while also breaking with the extreme logical empiricism of the analytics. Of course, not all naturalist authors consider themselves necessarily analytic as well. Analytic naturalism is but one of its facets. But it is similar enough in method, and undoubtedly its brainchild, even if by criticism of its overwhelming focus on linguistic analysis. American philosopher Willard Quine was another external partner of the Vienna Circle who focused on the naturalization of epistemology. Like Wittgenstein, he realized that the predominant tradition in philosophy tended to base most theories in the foundationalist aspect of knowledge. He would use Descartes as a reference for traditional philosophical theories, or first philosophy as he refers to it, in order to illustrate how they would support all of their arguments on elemental truths, much like the logical positivists did, and this would lead to the dogmatic perspective of foundationalism. This becomes an endless, vertical, ever-returning endeavor without much progress, as all knowledge comes back to the basic, unquestionable, and unchanging truths. Quine, however, influenced by Dewey and realizing the importance of the social context and our imperfect reasoning in the scientific endeavor, proposed a coherentist approach to knowledge construction, cyclical as the foundationalists, however oriented toward a self-correcting relationship between our worldview and the logical foundations of our criteria for truth. His paper, Two Dogmas of Empiricism, is probably one of the most influential philosophy texts of the past century. In his perspective, we must dialogue with cognitive psychology to understand the limitations of our information input through our senses and how we socially develop scientific knowledge to explain it toward our logic models of the world, which would alter given new information and also provide an enhancement to our perception of the world in an endless cycle where the manner in which we acquire knowledge enhances how we understand reality. This version of philosophical naturalism would be groundbreaking and highly influential even outside of epistemology. American philosopher Wilfrid Sellars, son of evolutionary naturalist philosopher Roy Sellars, also attacked this foundationalist perspective, referring to it as the myth of the given, where the semantics of a word would be a given, an obvious connection to its sound or symbols, as knowledge would have an inherent and necessary network of meaning according to this tradition. Very similarly to Quine's position, Sellars focuses his criticism on the fact that the knowledge we apprehend cannot be different in substance from the physiological mechanisms involved in their input process. A direct attack to both the logical positivists and previous schools of thought, like rationalism and idealism. This would also be his criticism of Quine, as he denies even that there would be a separate process of experience evaluation of our cognitive framework, as both would be inherently indissoluble. This is a clear and deliberate influence of continental phenomenology, given its focus on the subject's perception in and of itself for a theory of knowledge, as even though he was a prominent analytic, he often cited authors from both traditions. In 1963, within this ever-shifting landscape of philosophy, and especially epistemology and language, American philosopher Edmund Gettier wrote a short 3-page paper with a simple yet very effective argument, which utterly redirected the discourse in those areas and is still very relevant. By then, the standard epistemological definition of knowledge, tracing all the way back to ancient Greece, and in particular Plato's dialogue Titeto, was associated with a true justified belief, which means a person has a belief in something about the world which not only is true, but also has and is aware of the reasons for assessing its truth. Gettier criticizes this traditional position on knowledge by pointing out a systemic flaw within this perspective, where a person can have a true justified belief but have no actual knowledge. For example, let's say you saw, among several other people, me, Dave, walking down the street in front of your house one afternoon. You were sure it was me, and thus you had the belief that you saw me walking by your house in the afternoon. However, you discover later, by watching security footage and following me on social media, that I had recently cut my hair differently, and so I was not that person you thought was me. But you also discover that, around that time, I myself actually had passed in front of your house, and you saw me but did not recognize me. Clearly, you had a true and justified belief of the event, but could you claim that, before watching the security camera footage, you had true knowledge? Of course not. This develops the epistemological debate toward new horizons of attempting to define what knowledge would configure, while also setting the final nail in the coffin for metaphysical theories which relied on this definition. Since then, philosophers have debated if and how this definition holds up, and whether we can save it by adding another clause, that is, strengthening either the conditions of justification, belief, or knowledge. We should give Gettier some credit for shaking two millennia of epistemological tradition in just three short pages. In this context, American philosopher Hilary Putnam, one of Quine's most famous students, attuned much of his work with the second Wittgenstein and the current discussions on epistemology toward what he called the death of ontology, or of metaphysical theories of language and knowledge. Going beyond the coherentist, anti-foundationalist Quinean perspective of truth and meaning, Putnam brings mathematics and physics to thoroughly criticize Heidegger and metaphysicians in general. He does so by claiming that any concept can be associated with other concepts as freely as we want, as long as we can communicate with others using them. Any concept, then, broadly speaking, can represent any association of things in the world without requiring a metaphysical anchor to support it. If you take a shoe and the Eiffel Tower, both share concepts such as left, solid, and others, even though they seem utterly different. Thus, meaning does not need to have any sort of ontological foundations, and it is a useless tool which is dead, according to his interpretation, and succeeding in the original intent of Mach and the Vienna Circle. He even criticized some formulations of Quine's philosophy of mathematics as having a metaphysical approach, however faintly. This anti-metaphysical linguistic perspective of epistemology is what is called conceptual relativity, where optional languages describe objects by convention of the given group dealing with it in specific contexts. And again, similarly to Quine, this process would develop in a coherentist manner as our conceptual resources would interact with our capability of describing the world toward enhancing each other and thus allowing for greater knowledge of the world. Objectivity is then maintained, contrary to the first impression of the use of relativity, since it must occur within public discourse, and apparently contradicting definitions can also be sorted out by the same method. Mind, knowledge, and language become increasingly difficult to treat separately as the linguistic turn reaches widespread theories within, and even beyond, the analytic tradition. Keep in mind that, although we are separating these tutorials by general category, all of these theories interact with each other in one way or another during this period. In the next tutorial, we will focus again on language and the state of Western analytic and post-analytic philosophy during the late 20th century.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.